Macmillan Audio presents Canticle by Ken Scholes. Read for you by Scott Brick, William Dufris, Eliza Foss, Peter Larkin, and Stefan Rudnicki.
Prelude. Sunrise on the churning wastes was a terrifying glory. Each morning the gypsy scouts watched it from their station on the keeper's gate. First the cold air took on the warm scent of salt and sand. Then the sky was washed in deep purple, shot through with veins of red, twisting and spreading out on a flat horizon that stretched forever past the low hills that marked the Weimar Way, leading into the desolation of the old world. And in that moment before the sun rose red and angry as a fist, the world went silent and still. Today, in the heart of that moment, a brown bird dropped into the watch captain's net. He unrolled the tiny scroll it carried and squinted at it in the crimson light from the east. Then he whistled his men to third alarm and watched the front guard magic themselves to slip into the morning shadows. He hastily coded a note to Adric, the first captain of Rodolfo's gypsy scouts, and passed it to his birder. "See this to Seventh Forest Manor," he said. Then he climbed down the stairs to the base of the massive closed gate and stood to the side with his arms crossed. A metal man in robes approaches from the west. This was most irregular. General Rodolfo's metal men worked at the library, and their leader, Isaak, was the only one of their lot who wore robes. The watch captain scanned the road that led down from the jagged stone hills to the west. That winding road came from only one city. Windweir. Now a desolation because the Andro-Francines couldn't leave well enough alone. They'd brought back Jum'Yazir's 7 cacophonic deaths, and the spell had been their undoing. An entire city and its order snuffed out, ending their long guardianship of the light, the knowledge of the old world that had fallen to the same spell 2,000 years before. And now, it seemed, the metal man who had cast the spell and doomed the Andro-Francines approached his post unannounced. Most irregular, he said out loud. He watched the road, picking his men out easily despite the magics that concealed them. Each was a quiet, individual wind that gently moved the blades of grass and the pine boughs as the invisible scouts slipped into position. During the war last year, he'd been a lieutenant and he'd run with his men. Now, the double-edged blade of promotion set him apart from them. And with the promotion came a new assignment here in the mountains that divided the old world from the new. Birds flitted across the massive stones of the Weimar Way and the wind shifted, carrying the sound of metal footsteps. A robed figure limped into sight, wheezing and bubbling. One of its jeweled eyes hung by a strand of gold wires and the other rolled listlessly, its shutter bent open. The watch captain stepped forward, ready to bark orders. Rodolfo would have the head of any man who failed to help his friend, and the metal man Isaak was more kin than friend to the gypsy king. But he hesitated. "Brother Isaak?" The metal man looked up. Its voice burbled as its bellows wheezed. "My name is Charles," the metal man said in a watery voice. "I am the arch-engineer of mechanical science for the Andro-Francine Order in Windweir. I bear an urgent message for the hidden Pope Petronus. The library is fallen by treachery. Sanctorum Lux must be protected." With a click and a clack, the mechanical collapsed into a pile of steaming metal, bits of it sparking and popping. The watch captain shouted for another bird and whistled his men in from the forest. High above, a kin raven circled. Chapter 1. Rodolfo. Late afternoon sun washed the expansive forest in red, and Rudolfo watched it from the highest point of Library Hill. It had been a long day of paperwork amid the pandemonium that gripped his 7th Forest Manor's staff, and finally Rudolfo had fled under the pretext of an unscheduled inspection of the library construction. He had quietly strolled the basements and sub-basements, grateful for the break in routine. Of course, he couldn't blame the staff for the chaos. It was, after all, his firstborn feast they were preparing. In mere weeks, Rudolfo would see his first child into the world, and it was the custom of the forest gypsies to celebrate that event with great vigor. That it was Rodolfo's firstborn and an heir transformed the event into a minor affair of state, with dignitaries expected from a dozen or more houses. Even the Marsh King was attending. Rudolfo smiled at this, knowing that the large, hairy man who posed as the Marsh King did so at the command of a 15-year-old girl who was the true heir to that wicker throne. But tonight, Hanric would play the part of king alongside Rudolfo and the other lords in attendance. Those aspects of tonight's festivities bored Rudolfo. Instead, he thought about the men who were the true hosts of tonight's event. The men who rose to their captain's challenge to honor their gypsy king and the gypsy king to come. The gypsy scouts could be proud of their work. They'd hunted and fished for 6 weeks to stockpile the game required for the festivities. They'd sent birds and riders all over the named lands to gather the finest sampling of wines and spirits. They'd even hired in cooks from the Emerald Coasts to study the best of the forest recipes and reproduce them with southern augmentations to draw out the flavor. Rudolfo chuckled. Tonight, the Marsh King would sit to his left and the Entrelusion Ambassador would sit to his right. The Entrelusions had sent their ambassador because Erlund was beset by the fires of rebellion on the Delta. When Erlund's uncle, Sethbert, had destroyed Windweir, he'd hoped to shore up the Entrelusion economy by annexing the Ninefold Forest houses with the help of his puppet Pope. Rudolfo and his kinclave had pressed them back, and eventually Sethbert's plans were unraveled, and the overseer himself tried and summarily executed for the genocide of the Andro-Francine Order and their city. How long ago had that been? 6 months? 7? It had crawled like years. League upon league of paperwork, hour upon hour of meetings, entire days that slipped past him without seeing the sky or feeling the wind on the back of his neck. The last time he'd stood here, the bookmaker's tent was still below in the heat of second summer, as metal man and Andro Francine and Forrester worked together to reproduce what they could of Windweir's great library. Rudolfo paused and wondered where they had managed to store all of the books, and how long ago had it happened? What it pointed to disturbed him. I didn't even notice. There was a time when he would have picked up on the slightest difference in the length of any one of his scouts' beards. But now mountains of books vanished beneath his very feet, and it took him days to realize it. He heard the clicking and clacking, the slightest wheeze of bellows, and turned to watch his metal friend approach. "Lord Rudolfo," a metallic voice asked. "Isaak," Rudolfo said. "You found me." Isaak stepped into view. "Yes, Lord." He paused, smoothing his Andro-Francine robes with his metal hands. "I trust you found your inspection satisfactory." Rudolfo chuckled. He should have known the metal man would worry. "You are doing wonderful work here, Isaak." Isaak blinked. "Actually, Lord, there are many more besides myself performing this work. The list is rather extensive, but I have a file of names in my office for your review. Or I could recite them." Rudolfo raised a hand. "A compliment to all involved," he said. Isaak nodded. "Thank you, Lord. We serve the light." "We do indeed," Rudolfo said. "But truly, Isaak, You are a fine foreman for this work. Isaak inclined his head slightly. Thank you, Lord. Might I add that Lieutenant Nebios has been extremely helpful in that respect? Rodolfo had seen Neb's leadership throughout the grave digging of Windweir. That was when he'd first recognized that there was a fine captain buried in the lad. And some of Isaac's methods looked surprisingly similar to Neb's. So he's been advising you. Isaak blinked again. I have been making inquiries and cross-referencing them against library holdings on Francine observations of human leadership dynamics. He paused, releasing steam through the exhaust grate in his back. Neb is a natural leader. Rodolfo nodded and stroked his beard. Yes, he said. I see that too. But beyond what Rodolfo saw, the Marsh folk saw Neb as the one who would someday find and take them to the new home as promised in their Book of Dreaming Kings. Rodolfo turned his eyes back to the forest and his home in it. The sun was nearly down now, and the lights of the manor and the town called to Rodolfo. High above, as the sky went from purple to charcoal, swollen stars pulsed to life, and a blue-green sliver of moon danced behind a hazy veil of cloud. Rodolfo drew in a lungful of night air and smelled the roasting meat from the kitchens far below. I suppose we should get ready for the feast, he said, clapping Isaak on the shoulder and feeling the cool metal beneath the rough wool robe. Isaak nodded. Lady Tam sent a scout for you. I told him I would pass her message along. Rodolfo chuckled. A few weeks earlier and she'd have come herself, but the river woman insisted she rest now. She'd balked initially, but at the last accepted the midwife's instruction and forced herself to bed. Rodolfo knew better than to taunt the tiger in her cage. I was finished here, he said, turning to Isaak. Walk with me. They walked in silence among the massive scattered stones that were slowly taking shape. The air was cold on Rodolfo's face, and his breath showed. Picking his way carefully through last week's snow, he and Isaak descended the hill that was gradually transforming the Ninefold Forest, turning it into the center of the named lands. It had already started, of course, not long after Petronus had executed Sethbert and transferred the wealth of the Andro-Francine Order into Rodolfo's name for the reestablishment of the library. And just yesterday, another university, this one a larger bookhouse out of Turum, brought their petition to establish a presence near the great library. Rodolfo had listened to their request, told them he was honored by their interest in the Ninefold Forest, and that he would take the matter under consideration. It was the fourth university to ask in as many months, and he wasn't sure how long he could keep them at bay. Rodolfo's boot slipped on a patch of snow-crusted ice, and he stumbled. He felt a strong metal hand grip him before he could fall. He glanced over at Isaak. Thank you. Isaak nodded and waited until Rodolfo was steady before releasing him. They reached the bottom of the hill and followed the road back into town. Already, the forest between the hill and the town was thinning for new construction. Soon, Rodolfo's seventh forest manor and the small town that surrounded it would grow into a city. What would my father think of this? Rodolfo paused. Orphaned at 12, he rarely thought about his father. But he thought about him more now that he stood on the edge of fatherhood. A handful of Rodolfo's gypsy scouts fell in around them as they walked. They hadn't yet changed into their dress uniforms, and their rainbow-colored woolen trousers and shirts were damp from the forest. Uncharacteristically, they grinned at their general. He smiled back at them. I hear you've pulled together a firstborn feast like no other before it, he said to them. Their grins widened and then vanished as first Captain Adric approached from town. His face looked worried, and he gripped a note in his hand. For a moment he seemed to study Isaak and then fixed his eyes on Rodolfo. I've just had two birds from the wall. Rodolfo stopped. They had inherited the watch on the keeper's wall when they took on rebuilding the library. The mountain range separated the named lands from the churning wastes, the ruins of the old world. The Androfrancines had controlled access to the one pass until Sethbert broke their back and Petronus dissolved the order, passing its role on to Rudolfo and his ninefold forest houses. Shepherd of the Light, he thought. What is happening at the wall? He took the notes and read them quickly. Coded into the message was an emphatic urgency. A metal man, clothed in robes, claiming to be an arch-engineer of the Order's Office of Mechanical Science, in a city that was now desolated. I bear an urgent message for the hidden Pope Petronus, Rudolfo read. Sanctorum lux must be protected. He looked up from the note and turned to Isaak. What is the name of the engineer who created you? Isaak blinked, his eyes flashing golden in the crisp twilight. Brother Charles, Lord. Rudolfo nodded. Yes, Brother Charles. Arch-engineer of the Androfrancine Office of Mechanical Science. Isaak nodded. Yes, Lord. He stroked his beard. When was the last time you saw him? Gears whirred to life inside the metal man and he shuddered, venting steam into the cold night. The Mecho servitor paused. The evening before the city fell. He had given me my assignment and sent me with the Grey Guard escort into the spell vaults. So it was possible that he could have escaped, Rudolfo thought. And perhaps he knew of Petronus. It certainly wasn't impossible, though the old man had surely kept his secret from most. But it did not explain the metal man. And we liberated all of your... He searched for the proper word. Peers from Sethbert's camp. Isaak nodded. I've accounted for my brothers. Rudolfo nodded. He looked at Adric now. What do you think? Adric's hands moved quickly into the sign language of the gypsy scouts. I don't like it, he signed. I think we ride for the keeper's wall and see for ourselves what this is about. Rudolfo looked to his men and then to his first captain. They would go with me now, firstborn feast or not, if I said we must. The scouts were sons of scouts and had served the general of the wandering army and lord of the ninefold forest houses as their fathers before them had, raised on the knives and the powders. And Adric himself was Rodolfo's best friend's firstborn son. Gregric and Rudolfo had been close since childhood, and when Lord Jacob and his wife were murdered, Rudolfo had taken the turban and passed the first captaincy to his friend. They'd fought together in many political skirmishes and helped divert resurging heresies at the Order's behest, equally earning their reputations as fierce leaders and formidable strategists. But Rudolfo knew the truth. A leader is only as capable as the men he commands, and his men were the best in the New World. Their loyalty is nearly love, he realized. They learn it from their fathers. The reality of that gave him pause, and a thought pushed at his mind. He shoved it aside, forcing his attention to the matter at hand. I concur with you, Adric. Then he used the hand language of the gypsy scouts in such a way that none could possibly miss it. But tomorrow morning is soon enough. We feast tonight as these men honor my first fatherhood. The gypsy scouts were silent. But Rodolfo's eyes darted over to see several of them grinning again. He smiled at them and inclined his head. As they took to the road, making their way through the bustling streets of his growing tribe, Rudolfo brought back the thought he had pushed away. These men, he realized, were yesterday's children.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.